Now, God, we ask that you be with us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
A couple of announcements, and then we're going to get out of your way. Okay. Tomorrow night there is a rehearsal for the Easter play. You guys have the latest controversy. Elevation Church is saying they don't want to use the word Easter resurrection. They want to say something else, and people are up in uproar about it. I don't care what you call it. He lives. Right? So we're just going to celebrate the fact that he lives, okay? No argument over semantics. So Easter resurrection, he lives play, whatever you want to call it, it'll be, the rehearsal will be here tomorrow night at 6. 6 p.m. I don't know how to argue with nobody. So rehearsal will be here at 6. A lot of people, your children are in it. If you want your child to be in it, it's not too late. Bring them here tomorrow night at 6. We also have adults making cameos in the play. So 6 o'clock we'll be rehearsing. At 5 o'clock, we're going to meet with our street team. The teams are being combined, street team and evangelism. And if you, we're going to start a little, I guess, 3-week refresher course to kind of build a foundation to this ministry. If you can't be here tomorrow night, that's fine. You can jump in when you get here. We'll have material for your attention, for your reading, for your study, all that kind of stuff. But that'll be tomorrow night at 5. So 5 o'clock, we're meeting as an evangelism team. 6 o'clock, will be a rehearsal. This is Palm Sunday. That's coming up. Palm Sunday is we celebrate Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. And we're leaning towards the road to Easter resurrection. You got it, he lives, whichever way you want to call it, right? That Sunday falls on the 31st. So what I'll ask, and I'm not making this appeal to everyone, we all know that Easter resurrection, he lives, he got up Sunday, is one of the most well-attended Sundays in church history. So people come that haven't been to church all year long, right? So I'm asking that you all, pray for 3 things. One, that we be hospitable, be welcoming. No one wants to feel judged and condemned when they walk into church on Easter. Y'all know how we get. Where you been all year? Stop all that foolishness, right?
Yeah.
Just embrace them and let them know how glad you are to see them. Two, that we be hospitable. Part two, if you get to church and someone's sitting in your normal seat, find another seat, please. Please, if I find out one of y'all called a visitor, because that's where you park, then we don't have a problem at the church, right? Okay, and then number three, that God prepares their hearts to receive something.
Amen.
They may think they're coming to church just for Easter. He lives, he got a resurrection. But we're praying that they get more than what they asked for.
Yes.
Okay?
Amen.
So we have about 2.5 weeks to get that together, okay? Then the following week, first Saturday, our men will be here. We'll have our men's breakfast, our lunch and men's breakfast. Did we do say 9 a.m. before? Is it 9 a.m.? 9 a.m., all right. Brothers, whether you're part of the church or not, ladies, if you have a man in your life that needs to fellowship with some men, bring them here, drop them off. We're going to eat, we're going to fellowship, have a good time. You like to eat? You like to eat? Come on and eat with us, man. We have a full spread out. We got some men that can throw down and burn in the kitchen, so we have a good time, right? And then the following Saturday, the ladies will be together at 11 o'clock. So men, we go from like 9 to like 10:45. Ladies go from 11 to like 7 that evening. Y'all from a whole shift. And I'm like, still no security. We're just here, right? But we're here. Second Saturday of 11. And then the following Sunday, April 14th, the men will be taking over the worship service. You all, Sister Phyllis, you can have a seat. The ladies that some of the things throughout the service, you all can have a seat, and then we're going to take over that Sunday. And for those that are part of our worship team that Tuesday, you all stay home, because if you come, the men will be having a worship rehearsal. So you can come and see what the Lord's going to do, what you're going to sing. The men will be doing the worship.
When is it?
April 14th, second Sunday.
I thought it was just
we changed it. No, we changed it. Y'all didn't hear nothing the last 4 minutes? All they heard was breakfast and then Sunday. That's all they heard. Okay.
Okay,
I'm better. Tomorrow, there is a mobile medical van on the ski. 5 p.m. Our evangelism team will come together and meet for one series out of three to discuss outreach and how we're going to attack this community. If you can't be here tomorrow, get in when you can. There'll be material for you to read. But wait, there's more. Then at 6 p.m., there'll be a play rehearsal for the Easter Resurrection He Lives, He Got Up Sunday play. If your child wants to be in the play, bring them. If you're in the play, make sure they're here for a rehearsal. This Sunday is not Midweek Sunday, it's Palm Sunday.
Oh.
We're going to celebrate Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. And it's going to pave the way through the week to celebrate his road to the cross. Sunday morning will be Easter Resurrection. He got up. He lived Sunday on the 31st of March.
Amen.
We ask to pray for three things. One, that you be hospitable, that we be hospitable. Don't condemn anybody who hasn't been to church all year. Embrace them. Two, don't get an attitude because they sin against you. And three, we pray that they receive something, that God prepares our hearts to receive something.
Amen.
Everybody say, that's the end of March.
End
of March. Now let's turn to April. First Sunday in April will be our men's fellowship breakfast at 9 a.m. We'll be here eating and fellowshipping. Second Saturday of April will be our women's fellowship at 11 a.m. They'll be here doing that and then some. April 14th. Second Sunday in April will be Men's Sunday. The men will take over the worship service and lead it from start to finish.
Amen.
Our ladies, thank you all for what you do all year long, that you can take the rest and just enjoy the Lord for the day.
Amen.
The Tuesday before that, April 14th, will be a worship rehearsal just for the men only. So our worship leaders who lead us in the worship into the presence of God every Sunday, you all can have a seat. We will have the men. If I have to do it again in Spanish, give me 15 minutes. I have Google Translate with me, I'm all right. For now, that's all y'all got. Okay. Now. Woo. Y'all got it now? We get it?
Amen. All right. Amen.
All right. You know, I'm here to serve. So Minister Flo is coming, and she's giving that look like she's ready. I don't mess with her. She like to fight. I'm playing. She's coming with the Bible Sunday tonight. Can we say amen?
Amen.
The microphone, by the way.
Yeah, you know, I'm here to say. We can't hear you.
I'm going to try to put this back. Amen. Can you hear me?
Yes.
No.
I just want to first give honor to God to have the opportunity to stand before you, amen, and
amen.
Just the Holy Spirit to give me the strength. This has been one of those weeks, amen.
Amen.
But just going through God's word every time we have that opportunity, it is truly, truly a blessing,
mm-hmm.
And we're able to feed our souls. Tonight we'll be in 2 John, if you want to turn there. I'll give you a minute, but we will be focusing on false prophets. Will be a part of the lesson. So when you're there, say amen.
Amen.
And it's 11 scriptures, so yes, it's not very, very long, but it's powerful, depending on how you want to receive it.
Okay.
I'll go through it briefly if you want to just follow along, or you can write it down and read it later. But the Word of God says, the elders unto the elect lady and her children, whom I love in the truth, and not only, but also that they have known the truth, for the truth's sake, which dwelleth in us and shall be with us forever. Grace be with you, mercy and peace from God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of the Father, in truth and love.
Mm-hmm.
I rejoice greatly that I found of thy children walking in truth as we receive a commandment from the Father. And now I beseech thee, lady, not as though I wrote a new commandment unto to thee, but that which we have from the beginning, that we love one another. And this is love, that we walk after this commandment. This is the commandment, that as ye have heard from the beginning, ye should walk in. For many deceivers have entered into the world, and confess not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. This is a deceiver and of an antichrist. Look to yourselves, as we lose not those things which we have wrought, but that we receive a full reward. And that's to verse 8. I just want to stop there for a second and just go over, because what John is really addressing at this time is that the church, and what we would say the elect lady, but in reference to the church and our job and our assignments and what we as believers should be doing, and also addressing false prophets. And as I was starting looking at the lesson, we said, well, false prophets, false doctrine, things of that nature, you know, as Christians, do we really know what that is? Do we really know what we're entertaining, to really know that the things that we're receiving, and you think that you have to be in the company of someone, it could be the things that we're listening to, it could be the people that we're inviting in our homes, it could be the people at our jobs that you're there to do a job, but you're there entertaining in other areas. So it kind of got a little deep when it went into as far as the false doctrine and the things that we entertain. And as Christians, we find out these things and we know these things by, one, we have to study. You know, the Bible tells us in 2 Timothy that we should study to show ourselves approved.
Amen.
You know, and if you're not in the Word of God, you don't know if somebody's telling you right from wrong. You don't know if they're telling you the true Word of God.
Amen.
And people can, just as I gave that scripture and intentionally I stopped, I didn't finish it. So people will just take a part of a scripture and use it to their benefit, to manipulate you, to deceive you, to control you. It's a list of things that goes on with that. And in the whole process of it, you're not following God's commandment.
Mm.
And you can only serve him or the enemy. And if we're not acting and walking in love and in faith and all these things that we're commanded to do, then you're doing the opposite of what God called us to do. So that's where I really wanted to start, for us to get an understanding of what we are really entertaining. And it goes as even far as, like I said, the people that we're around, but also, if you really want to go deeper, you know, what are we allowing in our homes? I'm not going to point nobody out, but you know, the doorbell rings or the ring system pop up and people standing there with their pamphlets and they want to tell you all about their religion. But as Christians, are we bold enough to say, well, I understand that you're here to tell me about your God or who you serve or your beliefs, but are you bold enough to grab your Bible and say, well, let me, since you're on my property, let me tell you about the Jesus and the God that I serve. They take off running. They take off running, or they don't have time.
Right.
So I'm saying at some point we have to get bold enough.
Yes.
Really bold enough. And in order to do so, we have to know the Word.
Mm-hmm.
We really have to know the Word. And in doing those things, you can do them in love. It doesn't have to, you don't have to be disrespectful or rude or knock anyone's religion, which you most definitely have to stand boldly when we do those things. And it says, and it continues to say, a workman that needed not to be ashamed, rightly divided the word of truth.
Mm-hmm.
Being ashamed, like, are you ashamed to talk about God? Are you ashamed to profess what he's done for you and your family and your friends and things of that nature? And most Christians will say, no, I'm not ashamed. But when you're at the grocery store and your old buddy is standing over when you at work and the people come to the counter and they calling you every name but a child of God, and you're entertaining, when you respond in a negative manner, you're entertaining that.
Right.
And is it a crime to say, well, God bless you?
Amen.
No, it's not. I do it all day long because we have to understand that we're battling with the enemy. And if you're not ready for war, you're going to be defeated.
Mm-hmm.
And in order to go forward with that, you have to know the word.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not saying you have to know it verbatim. You don't have to know it verbatim. God would love for all of us to know this and be able to use it when appropriate and when fit. But when you start reading the word, it's amazing how the Holy Spirit will bring things back to you.
Yes. Amen.
And you'll know when to use it and how to use it so you're not being misled by other people and their beliefs.
Mm-hmm.
I was talking to someone today, matter of fact, and I addressed an issue because I just didn't feel comfortable with the conversations that were being said and discussed in front of a chaplain. I mean, where's the respect?
Right.
You know, we have to start showing respect for our elders. We have to start showing respect for our families. We have to start showing respect for ourselves. But if we can't do that, we can't have respect for God because He gave us the commandment here to love. And I don't want to go too far off, but it hit me so because we come to church, and I say we because I'm guilty. We come to church, and we'll take what Bishop says for Bible and truth. But how many of us are really opening up our word and really going back studying and going back to really see what is in the word and if that's true?
Amen.
And it's good to take notes. I mean, some people, they can do it by memory. Some people already know the word. Some people understand it. Some people, it's new to them. So they said, well, Bishop said. Bishop didn't say nothing.
Right.
Bishop got up here, open up the word of God, the same thing that we have.
Yes.
And he read. He didn't add nothing to it.
Nope.
He didn't take nothing away. He gave the same opportunity that we have during Sunday service and Wednesday nights and any other services that we have to understand what God is commanding us to do. But how can we fight the enemy and we understand when somebody's presenting us with false doctrine if we don't know the word?
Amen. That's good.
We don't know it. And a lot of it is just having that relationship with God to be able to use discernment. I can listen to something and it'll come back to me and I'm like, that didn't sound too right. I'm not going to argue with them, but it just don't sound too right. And you really do not have to entertain it. And it's and a few things I just wrote down just for just to share with you is that how can we study to show ourselves approved? Well, one, we have to read the Bible, but not only read the Bible, we have to do it with a purpose.
Come on.
Because you can read the word and not understand the word. You can read the word and not be able to relay it to someone else.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and a lot of times what I try to do, even with, you know, just things that I enjoy, is break things down Barney style. If you can break it down to a child's level, then probably much anybody can get where you're going and what you're trying to do. So when they were talking about the churches and being and allowing people to come into your home, it goes for the church too. Just because our doors is open don't mean that our eyes shouldn't be.
Okay. Come on.
We have to be careful. You know, we're very welcoming. We're taught. We do things decently and in order, but we have to be as children and obedient children of God, we have to be aware of our surroundings.
Come on.
And that's even at church.
Mm-hmm.
If something ain't right, you do it, and you do it in love, you do it with respect, but we're doing it unto God. And we have to stop, and we have to start here with each other because it's serious. You know, that just touched when I was just going through the lesson, was just going through my spirit, just like we have to, it starts with you. And when I say you, or he was talking to me, it starts with you.
That's right.
You have to start understanding the things that are being said and being able to dissect it to where you're able to deliver it to somebody to where they can understand. also, we have to pray throughout the day.
Yes.
We have to pray, because one thing I've learned to pay attention to is that the enemy is diligent.
Mm-hmm.
He's persistent.
Yes.
And I hate to use the word in the same sentence, but he's faithful.
Mm-hmm.
And his children are faithful to what they believe. I was just scrolling through something, and I think it was Ambrose or somebody, and I grew up a Christian, and I just don't believe that God is real. I don't believe this because I never felt the Holy Spirit, or I've never felt this, and I've never felt that. But are you walking in his truth? Or are you going by what you've seen? So it does take, it takes time, and being able to walk in truth requires that, you know, a heart in the believers, that we really understand the lifestyle that we live reflects God and what he wants for us. We can stand here and talk all day about what we should be doing, but if we're not actually doing it, what good is it, and how is an honor to the Father? You know, and I was convicted. Because I know sometimes my emotions or my feelings or just the way that I perceive that things should be, I allow, you know, the enemy to put thoughts. He don't control me. He don't control me, but he will put thoughts.
Yeah.
He will put people in your path.
Mm-hmm.
He will put people from your church. He will put, I mean, he will use anybody to get to you, to divert you from what you're supposed to do, and that's for us to be obedient and walk in love and
mm-hmm.
be Christ.
Amen.
So we have to take steps to move towards making a better community. And a community of believers. You know, if you believe something strongly, you're going to go after it. You're going to be persistent. When you want that new car, you save it up. Are you waiting till your taxes come? Are you trying to find the best deal? We have to do those same things when it comes to the Lord. Because we all make mistakes, but we have to be on that path to understand what is it that I need to do when it's time for me to move forward and face that enemy. And these are just a few things that we need to do. And another thing that I find that God has been assigning me with that I did not ask for, but when you're obedient, obedience is better than sacrifice. I said, Lord, don't assign me nobody with no attitude.
Lord Jesus.
I'm being serious. My father-in-law sitting here, he's known me over 20-something years, and he knows that it is what it is. That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah.
Don't assign me nobody with no attitude. And what did he do?
First,
he assigned me somebody with attitude. It is amazing how the Holy Spirit will comfort you, protect you, guard your mouth, your mind, your walk, even your demeanor.
What you say.
He will. It happens.
Yeah.
And lady will tell you, it's times at work, I'm like, woo, wait a minute. But you have to see, and that's one of those things, accountable partner.
Mm-hmm.
You have to find somebody that's in the Word, that knows the Word, that walks in the Word, and not just talk in the Word.
Amen.
I said, we can get up here all day long, and we can do all this what you do, but
Amen.
It's what you do behind closed doors.
Mm-hmm.
It's what you do when you're at work.
Come
it's
on.
What you're doing when you're in the bathroom or on the phone. It's what you're doing. Even in your sleep, sometimes we go high and to the right because of what we went to, what the thoughts we had on our mind when we went to bed. And that's how the enemy works. We have to be careful. So what does it mean to be aware of a false prophet? A false prophet is a person who falsely claims the gift of prophecy, divine inspiration, or speaks of God, who makes such a claim of evil end. We have so many people that profess to be Christians, titles, I'll just say titles because the list goes on and on and on. But then you find out that not only is not that they're making mistakes or that they're, I don't want to say we're human, so we all fall short, but they're practicing a lifestyle of sin.
My God.
And we know that they're practicing. And you said, well, how am I entertaining? You're entertaining because you know he married or she married, and you're on the phone gossiping about what she should do to get his attention. You're entertaining. When somebody's not walking upright and doing what they have to do in church, and we walking around with attitudes, and we not, and you sitting up here, old sister, it's gonna be a, no, it's not gonna be a, let me talk to you right.
Come on.
Because this is not the attitude that we should have as Christians. When we're getting, and I'm preparing us, the point I'm getting to is when the time it gets to the, when we get to the adversary, you don't have time, I don't have time to call it.
Right. That's right. That's right.
I don't have time to text evangelists. I don't have time to run next door to my father-in-law because he's in my face.
Yeah.
and he's ready for war. He's ready.
Come on, teach today.
But God tells us to use his word to fight.
Yes.
It's not with our power.
Yeah.
It's not our power. But when you fight the word, when God gave the enemy the word, what did he do? He fled, but it was for a season. He came back. So you may not be able to say, Lord is my shepherd, I shall not. The next time you might have to give me high, you don't know what scripture you're going to have to come with because you don't know how far he's coming.
Come on.
But you have to stay ready so you don't have to get ready.
Amen.
And I've learned just from the time of me moving and growing in God that the enemy is predictable. We can sit here and say, he did this to me, he did that, he did it. He's predictable.
Mm-hmm.
You know why I know it's predictable? Because he comes in the same form every time. He just used somebody else.
Yes.
So depending on what mood you're in is how you're going to allow him to affect you in your walk.
Mm-hmm.
If you woke up with an attitude and not blessed that God put breath in your body, you going to walk out there and somebody looks at you crazy and you cussing and fussing. If you late for work, because you didn't go to bed on time, what you were supposed to do. Now you flying down to 62. You flying down to 62 to talk crazy because people in your way, because they taking their time and they doing that too far. And you like, I didn't go to bed. This is the thing that I'm saying that God is ministering to me.
Right.
Following highway patrol, I'm right behind them. We're going to get there. But that's how we have to be when it comes to the Lord. We have to have that same energy when it comes to the Lord. And that's what we have. We have to be mindful. And 2 John reminds us of the church of the commandment to love one another. When you say love, you understand that love is more than just, I love Sister Lakeisha. She's so cute. I love she always comes and gives me a hug and she texts. Checks on me and I just love her. No, love is when she's not giving me a hug.
Right?
She's not in line to be right. She don't want to come over.
Yes.
When she's at church, she's feeling defeated and you go over there and you give her a hug.
Right.
That's love.
Amen.
It's not, don't call me. And I have my phone and I'm going to call, so I got to just check. But the point I'm making is that don't call me and tell me you didn't give me no hug today.
Come on.
Don't call me. I love everybody. That's what the love of God. But do not call me and tell me that I did not give you a hug today.
Amen.
And I'm saying that because I'm approachable and I'm human. Y'all don't know what I've been through the last 2 weeks where I need a hug. Why I had to call on the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Why I took a day just to just marinate and bask in his presence and ask God to give me the strength.
Mm-hmm.
Because I know whatever it is that you have for me is coming and I don't want to be ready. Sometimes we say, I don't want to be ready. So when we're acting in love, those texts that I send when I sit, they're sincere because I'm thinking about you and I love you. That's just how it is. And if I don't like you, I still love you because I'm not here to put here to. It's not about feelings.
Teach today.
It's about the commandments.
Yes. Teach today.
So when we have people coming in, we have sisters and brothers in Christ that's going through something, that's when we need to activate.
Yes.
We got to put self aside and we have to activate that. Because how can we build God's kingdom if we still walking around defeated?
Come on.
We can't. And I have to check myself daily. Daily I have to do it because I always have to end up doing something that I don't want to do. But it's not about me. It's about God. The second Apostle John was really the elect lady and her children, John 2:1. It was really unknown. He was addressing a family or specific group of people. Figuratively, I think he's talking to the church, just getting the attention, you know, of them to see, you know, the doors that are open that we have here. I've been to a lot of churches, dealt with a lot of people. And when you say love, love is unconditional.
Mm-hmm.
It's agape love, but when it comes to us, we fall short, but it's unconditional. Mm-hmm. And we are truly blessed here with the man of God and the woman of God that we have over this house. And
amen.
I'm going to share it because I'm not ashamed. But as an example, I text lady a lot and I let her know that it's not what she says up here. It's not the way she talks to other people. It's the way she holds herself accountable to God. And spiritually, if you really, really, really trying to move and you're trying to grow, God will show you things. Not just tell you, he will put people in your path to show you. This is how you carry yourself as a lady.
Mm-hmm.
This is how you dress and be modest. This is how you talk when you're talking to somebody that you really don't want to talk to and you want to put hands on. This is how you handle your family and you let your husband lead and you be that backbone. This, I'm telling you, the list goes on and on and on, but all this is done. It's done in love. So we have to understand that it's really not that complicated. And the children of, and as the children of God, we must strive to live out perfect harmony with love, truth, and obedience.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard being obedient, especially when you think you know everything.
Amen.
If we empty ourselves at that door and come in with nothing but what's in this word, you would be amazed how educated you could be. You would really be amazed. And I know sometimes I sit there and people are like, she got the meanest look on her face, or she not shouting, or she not doing nothing, but that's how I digest things. That's how the Spirit moves in me, because I have to, it has to make sense. It really has to make sense to me, and I have to process it like that because God is working on me too.
Amen.
But as leaders in the church and as children of God, we really have to understand that we have to be obedient and follow what it is in the direction that God has for us. But when it comes to preachers and teachers and God's words, stewards, things of that nature, you know, John is letting us know that deceivers exist. Like we exist, they exist.
Amen.
And then sometimes we have to ask ourselves, are you a deceiver? Mm-hmm. Are you moving in a deceitful manner?
Mm-hmm. Come on. Teach.
We really have to check ourselves, because we will sit back and we will think because we went to church on Sunday and we got full of the word that we can go to work on Monday and we can do what we want to do. We can say what we want to say. We can move how we want to move. It's not about that. And it doesn't have an age. It doesn't have an age on it. If you get into the word and you start studying and you start doing the things that you're supposed to do, God will put people in your path to help you grow. Some plant, some water.
Come
God
on.
Gives the increase.
That's it.
You can't plant and go straight to the increase.
Come on.
It don't work like that. It don't. But we have too many people moving in the flesh, but that's how they want to operate. Let me go ahead and do this good deed for this person because I want to reap something in return. That's not how God works.
Yes.
That's not how we work. invited them, or you started inviting them, or somebody invited them. That's water. How do you do that? With love.
Come on. Yeah. That's good.
You may not remember their name, but you'll remember their hand. You will give them a handshake.
Mm-hmm.
You give them a smile.
Yes.
You give them a hug. We can do all of those things.
Amen.
It's not hard, but we have to want to. And you do it one thing at a time. God did not design us to be octopus. We're not supposed to be running around the church like we're crazy and we got to do everything. Everything needs to be done decently and in order. If somebody has something to do, you need to do it. If you assigned to do something, you need to do it. If you're supposed to be in charge of something, you need to do it. Because what happens is, and language time, the body is only as good as the head.
Mm-hmm.
If we're not doing what we're supposed to do collectively, how can we grow?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm talking about just off a commandment. This is just the basics. Without going all into detail, God gave us a commandment to do something. In order for us to do that, we need to understand that the enemy is out there real and he's not playing. And we're not supposed to entertain the false teachers. Like I said, don't invite them in your home. Don't be contributing to them financially.
Mm-hmm.
How is that? If they talking about old Lucifer on Apple Music and who.com and shooting up the, you shouldn't even be downloading that.
That's right.
Come on.
You shouldn't even be downloading that.
Amen.
Why? Because now you've sown that stuff into yourself. And please believe, what you hear is what you will do.
Yeah.
What you hear is what you will say. That's why Sundays just can't cut.
Right.
Yeah.
Come on.
Half the time I can tell you that I'm being truthful and Bishop forgive me, but half the time I can't remember nothing Bishop said unless you talk about food or saying something funny.
Yeah.
we give
you.
You didn't forget, and I'm telling the truth. We forget because we're human.
Yes.
But if you go back and you reflect back on that word and you say, you know what, we were talking about staying in your lane.
Yes.
You know, you don't know how staying in your lane kept me in my lane to keep me with a check, to keep me out of jail. You don't know how staying in your lane will keep you in God's favor.
That's good.
I just share with my sister and my testimony.
Yes.
Staying in your lane, God will bring favor to you.
Yes.
You don't even have to die right. While you run and he at the end handing you the baton.
That's right.
That's all you have to do.
That's good.
But we have to have the tools to do it.
Mm.
Don't fellowship with them. Like I said, you have those family members, you have those cousins, you may have nieces, grandkids, I don't care what they are. And I'm being real.
Amen.
You have to cut that tie. And people think, well, that's my sister. And we've been through all this together. We've been through, I love my sister dearly, but I might talk to her twice a week. Because I don't even want to know half of what you're saying. I'm not paying attention. I'm eating an Uncrustable and watching TV. So now all I'm doing is just holding the phone.
Right.
You're not sowing anything into
right.
me. To where my times get hard and I need to go to the Father and I need prayer and I need prayer warnings and I need to, what you gonna say?
Right.
God bless you.
Right.
I need somebody that's ready to go to war. I need somebody that's not afraid to fast. I need somebody that's not afraid to walk through their house and shout. I'm not afraid of nobody to go in that door and get the anointing oil and get the walking through and praying to God all day for me because I'm going to do it for you.
That's right.
Yes.
That's
right.
Sometimes I scare myself. Oh, oh, oh. What's that? That was leaking down the wall. Something. Somebody was breaking. That's how
we have to be
bold.
Yes.
And if you know where you come from and you know where you're going,
my God.
You in that lane that you don't have to worry about getting out of. We don't have to worry about it. We have to understand that what John was saying is that deceivers are real.
Amen.
And you have to ask yourself, are you? Are you real about what God's telling us to do?
Mm-hmm.
Are we obedient with those things that God's given us? And we got to understand, everybody in this room is your brother or your sister.
Amen.
Family.
Mm-hmm.
And not by blood, the doctor blood, or the if I cut my hand blood, it's the blood that was shed on the cross.
Come on,
amen.
That flowing blood that makes us connected. Mm-hmm. And that's it's undefeated. It's undefeated. So why are we walking around scared and undefeated? Mm-hmm. I don't know why God put it on me, but to make it plain and clear, we have to get ready for war.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
But we can only do it if we trust one another.
Amen.
And we trust the word of God.
Amen.
We have to understand that in order for us to move forward, we most definitely have to hide this in our heart, mm-hmm, and pull it out when it's time to get down.
Amen.
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 And most definitely not be afraid, because they're out here. And I see it daily. You know, they people thinking it's the drugs, or they 5150. A lot of these people is really possessed.
Yep.
They was really out here. They really out here working for their master.
Yeah.
And they're not ashamed. I saw it for myself.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I saw it for myself. A lady sitting in there chanting and calling spirit. I got the praying, you walk in, I said, the devil is a lie, covering all of them. You come in, you come in, you come in, and I'm touching. Oh, she just talking. Mm-hmm. That's what she's saying.
Mm-hmm.
And she got into that car accident that next week. You don't understand what's out there. These people are out here, and how we studying and we doing what we have to do, they out here doing the same thing. And not only is that, they're studying our movements.
Come on.
They're studying our weaknesses. They're studying our failures. Why? So they can use it against us. And half the time, it's the people right there that know. So that's when you got to understand, when is it time to disconnect? People look at me crazy. Come on, all your kids gone? Yep. Shorty, yep, gone. What you do that for? It's time to disconnect.
Amen.
It's time to disconnect. And if I can disconnect from my child that ain't living right, baby, let me tell all y'all, I can disconnect from you.
Come on now.
Amen. And it's not in a mean way, but we gotta understand, if God comes first in your life, then that's how it has to be.
Yes.
Nothing else comes before him, because we serve a jealous God.
Come on.
And please believe, I don't want his wrath on me. So if little Keisha and little baby and all the rest of them got to go when they could, go do you.
Okay.
Go do you. But you're not going to do it in my house.
Amen.
In my house, we're going to serve the Lord.
Amen.
And if you can't abide by that, then you got to get going.
Yeah.
I told all of them when they live, you graduate, you ain't doing what you're supposed to do. We just put a U-Haul truck on the back of it, and you can just keep it moving. Because we laid the foundation. The same thing Bishop does on Sunday. He laid a foundation for us for Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. What you gonna build on?
Mm-hmm.
How many of us come back with that same slate of slab of cement that he laid on Sunday? And then they going, well, I had a rough week, and the devil, and this one, and Lord have mercy, Jesus help me. And he laid the foundation.
Come on.
The truth and tools is in the word.
Yes.
You didn't go home and build nothing. You didn't go home and build nothing. But hey.
That's good.
And come back Sunday again, and we're going to repeat. It's time to go to Home Depot, people.
Come on.
And I'm going to close with this. It's time for us to get it together. When I say us, I'm talking about me too. We got to get it together, and we got to stop playing. Just like the rules on the highway, the officer don't care that you don't know that the speed limit is 60. First thing he'll say, you know why I pulled you over? License and registration.
Right.
Well, no, officer, why are you pulling? Because you were speeding. Oh, well, officer, I didn't know that the speed limit was 60. He gonna tell you. So, I don't care. That's your job tonight. You go to the DMV and get the book. Google.
Yeah.
Read the sign that you sped past going on and past. He don't care. Because he got a job to do.
Mm-hmm.
think that we'll all be in a better place.
Our presence, we have a Savior, and that is Jesus Christ. Praise God.